Good evening, friends. Welcome once again to the Department of Medicine Academic Lunch. We are very grateful and thankful to Dr. Asha HS. He is a professor of endocrinology in CMT Vellore. She has been in CMT for many years and is a very wonderful teacher, a very good human being. And it's very kind of her to take the class for us today. She hasn't recently lost her mother, but still she has been kind enough to take the session for us. So thank you very much, Asha. We are very grateful. Why are we having a talk on young diabetes in medicine? Recently, we are seeing an explosion in the amount of type 2 diabetics or diabetes in our OPDs and inpatients. Many of them are young. And it's often confusing whether they have type 2 diabetes, do they have MODY, do they have FCPD, or are they just type 1, Flatbush, all these. And the tests for MODY are increasing every day, and they're often quite expensive. Each gene is quite costly. So the reason we want the talk is to first, what are the common causes of young diabetes that our department sees in endocrine and CMC or in India? What are the reasonable management strategy in a secondary care or tertiary care? So and what is our experience? So the apt person is really Dr. Asha. She's extremely hardworking, and even at odd hours, she'll be staying and seeing patients. So thank you, Asha. I hope you enjoy teaching us. And please stay back for a little while after your talk, because there'll be a lot of questions. If you could answer them on, Mohan will just read out the questions. It will be coming on the chat. So I'd urge everybody to switch off their audios. And if you have questions, keep typing them in the chat box. We will have few minutes in the end. I hope Dr. Asha can stay back and answer that. So with that, over to you, Asha. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And at the outset, I would like to thank sir and the Department of Medicine for giving us this opportunity to share our experience in managing young people with diabetes. And so to start with, when do we say a person has young onset diabetes? When a person is diagnosed with diabetes before the age of 25 to 35, then you would say that it is young onset diabetes. The criteria for diagnosis of diabetes in the young are the same as that of diabetes in adults, that is a fasting glucose more than 126, a 2 hours post glucose load more than 200, or a random glucose more than 200 in presence of symptoms, along with an HbA1c of more than 6.5. So I'll start with a description of three cases and then go over the approach to how to decipher the type of diabetes and the long-term management of these patients. So the first case is a 17-year-old girl studying in 12th standard. 2 months ago, she had contacted a doctor in her hometown because of weight loss of 19 kgs over 2 months, and she had an episode of DKA at that time. Aptly, she was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes with DKA. She was managed appropriately with IV fluids, potassium correction, as well as insulin infusion. Subsequently, just over a period of 2 months, she had widely fluctuating glucose levels, leading to multiple hospital admissions, either with hypo or hyperglycemia. The points to note here are that despite her being a 17-year-old girl, insulin was administered by her mother over the arms, and each needle was reused up to 8 times or more. And because of these frequent hospitalizations and fluctuating glucose levels, she found it difficult to cope with her studies at the right point in time. So she presented to us 1 month ago with abdominal pain, vomiting, and breathlessness. Because of the vomiting, she had stopped insulin for a day. At the time of presentation, she had tachycardia, tachypnea, blood pressure was low normal. Her glucose levels were high, 519, ketones were elevated, and she had moderate diabetic ketoacidosis. The second case is another 17-year-old girl who came 1 week after this girl got admitted. She also came with progressive weight loss of 9 kilos over 1 year. She wanted to join the nursing course, and one of her friends suggested that she should have a medical checkup, because most often nursing colleges do a medical checkup before they join. So that's when she discovered that she had urine glucose of 3+, and subsequently got tested and got to know that she has diabetes mellitus. Her postprandial glucose was more than 400. She had a family history in that her father had diabetes from the age of 42 years and he had already developed kidney disease. No other family members were affected. Her BMI was 26.4 kg per meter square. She had no acanthosis nigricans. Her further investigations showed her urine ketones to be positive, but her arterial blood gas analysis was normal. The third case is a boy who was born in 1996. We saw him at the age of 19 years. Prior to that, he was being managed by pediatric endocrinology. He was diagnosed to have diabetes at the age of 3 years. He never had DKA, but he was treated with insulin at a dose of 0.8 units per kg body weight. At the age of 15 years, he had persistent polyuria, polydipsia with uncontrolled diabetes, but his sodium was elevated and urine osmolarity was low, indicating that he had inappropriately dilute urine, indicating a diagnosis of diabetes insipidus, and he was started on treatment for that. So he came to us at the age of 19 years while he was on treatment with insulin and desmopressin. So his parents expressed concerns that he was not gaining height, his secondary sexual characters were not progressing. He was 141 centimeters at the age of 19 years, which was less than the fifth centile for age. And though his parents were tall, he was very short. He had 6 ml testis bilaterally and pubic hair tanner stage 2, again inappropriately retarded for a 19-year-old boy. He also complained of progressive decline in vision and had bilateral optic atrophy. And he had recurrent episodes of urinary tract infection with pyelonephritis at least 2 to 4 times per year over the preceding 3 years. Ultrasound showed bilateral hydroureteronephrosis and an atonic bladder for which he was advised intermittent self-catheterization. So you can see here the spectrum of different types of diabetes and different causes of diabetes in similar age group of around 17 to 19 years in these three different cases. And so I would first start with the classification of diabetes. In continuation, this patient also had psychiatric disturbances and he was born to third degree consanguineous parents, and 2 of his siblings both had diabetes and diabetes insipidus. So the ADA has classified diabetes based on the etiology of diabetes as type 1 diabetes, which is due to beta cell destruction leading to absolute insulin deficiency, which is either immune mediated or idiopathic, and type 2 diabetes, which has a combination of predominantly insulin resistance to predominantly defective insulin secretion. Among the other types of diabetes, we have the genetic defects in beta cell function, where we have the different types of MODY. Then we have neonatal diabetes, which could be transient or permanent depending on the genetic mutation. Then we have mitochondrial mutations causing diabetes. Among the other genetic defects in insulin action, here we have different syndromes associated with insulin resistance, as well as lipoatrophic or lipodystrophic form of diabetes. Disorders of the exocrine pancreas, we are all familiar with patients coming to us with pancreatitis, fibrocalcific pancreatic diabetes, who have diabetes as a presentation at young age. Among the endocrinopathies, the most common ones are acromegaly and Cushing syndrome presenting with diabetes. Among the others, we have glucagonoma, pheochromocytoma, rarely hyperthyroidism or aldosterone producing tumors. Among the drugs causing diabetes, we are all familiar about glucocorticoids, phenytoin, nicotinic acid, thiazides, etc. Infections like congenital rubella and CMV have been shown to trigger diabetes. Uncommon forms of immune-mediated diabetes include diabetes associated with Stiffman syndrome, anti-insulin receptor antibodies, and the other genetic syndromes where diabetes is also one of the manifestations, like in Downs, Klinefelter's, Turner syndromes, various obesity syndromes, the Lawrence-Mountbatten, Prader-Willi syndrome, etc. And lastly, in this classification is gestational diabetes, which is diabetes diagnosed for the first time during pregnancy. So when we think of a young person with diabetes, it could be any one of these. And so now we will go over the three cases and decipher how we are going to approach a young person with diabetes. So that was the ADA, and the WHO in 2019 revised their classification of diabetes, and in addition to the classical type 1 and type 2 diabetes, they introduced this new terminology of hybrid forms of diabetes. So in this hybrid forms of diabetes, we have the entity called slowly evolving immune mediated diabetes of adults, which was previously known as LADA, or latent autoimmune diabetes of adults. Here, the person could be obese or lean, they are antibody positive, and they have retained beta cell function. So their beta cell function is not almost completely gone by the time of diagnosis. They still have some beta cell function, and because of that, they can manage with oral antidiabetic agents for anywhere between 6 months to 5 years. And within 5 years, they require insulin due to beta cell destruction. The other entity is ketosis-prone diabetes. This is a form of diabetes which was initially described in Africa, seen commonly in obese people where there is a family history of type 2 diabetes, but they present with diabetic ketosis or ketoacidosis and they require insulin therapy initially. But after this initial state of DKA, after it is treated, their beta cell function recovers and they don't require further insulin therapy and they can be managed with oral agents. So they have features of type 1 in the form of DKA and they recover beta cell function similar to type 2 diabetes. So these are the two hybrid forms of diabetes. In addition, under the WHO classification, the same monogenic diabetes, defects of exocrine pancreas, endocrine disorders, drug-induced infections, genetic syndromes, all these are incorporated. The WHO has also added another new terminology called unclassified diabetes. So this terminology can be used initially in a patient where it is not clear as to what type of diabetes we are dealing with, and this terminology can be used for a short while before we make a definitive diagnosis. Diabetes in pregnancy is further classified as diabetes type 1 or type 2 first detected in pregnancy, and as gestational diabetes. So coming back to our first case, she had recurrent episodes of DKA and wildly fluctuating glucose levels, indicating that her beta cell function was very, very poor. So this girl is a classical example of a type 1 diabetes with DKA. Her GAD antibody levels were very high, more than 2000 international units per ml. Ultrasound of the pancreas was normal, and so she was labeled as type 1 diabetes. During her hospital stay, by about 5th, 6th day after she recovered from DKA, she started complaining of increased hunger. She also had tremors of the hands and hyperdefecation. So at that time when we examined her again, we found she had a soft goiter, grade 2, and she had tremors of the hands with persistent tachycardia. That's when we suspected that she could possibly have Graves' thyrotoxicosis, because autoimmune endocrinopathies may occur together as part of polyglandular autoimmune syndromes. And so we confirmed a diagnosis of Graves' disease and started her on anti-thyroid medication. With that, her glucose fluctuations came down and she is able to manage her diabetes better with insulin as well as anti-thyroid drugs. A large proportion of our patients, when they come with DKA, they present with abdominal pain, which is seen in about 40 to 75% of patients coming with DKA. And the reasons for that are acute hyperglycemia, which itself impairs the GI motility, especially causing decreased motility in the stomach and the gallbladder. And these patients can present with abdominal pain and vomiting. Also, because of the increased free fatty acid flux, which happens due to ketosis and ketoacidosis, there can be a rapid expansion of the hepatic capsule, which can also cause abdominal pain. Mesenteric ischemia is another reason proposed as the cause of abdominal pain. Among the other causes, we have pancreatitis, hepatitis, and pyelonephritis, which could be precipitating factors for DKA and thereby also causing abdominal pain. Type 1 diabetes is the commonest type of diabetes in children, which is characterized by absolute insulin deficiency. The incidence varies anywhere between 4 to 10 per lakh population in the Indian setting. The prevalence of 3 to 18 per lakh children less than 14 years of age. The prevalence of type 1 the incidence of type 1 diabetes is increasing annually by about 3%, especially in the younger age group. It is characterized by severe insulin deficiency due to autoimmune beta cell destruction, and exogenous insulin is absolutely essential to prevent ketosis and death. So in the evolution of type 2 diabetes, various stages of evolution have been described now. A person with genetic predisposition based on their HLA haplotype DR3, DR4 or DQ2, DQ8 is classified as is the initial stage, and subsequently a trigger in the form of a viral infection, vitamin D deficiency, early exposure to gluten in the diet, any of these may trigger off beta cell autoimmunity, leading to beta cell destruction by the T cells, as well as production of multiple antibodies associated with diabetes by the B cells. This is the stage of asymptomatic autoimmunity. Subsequently, because of beta cell destruction, there is progressive decline in beta cell function, which often happens very quickly, and it progresses through asymptomatic dysglycemia, asymptomatic diabetes, to new diagnosis of diabetes, and subsequently leading on to the complications of diabetes when it is not adequately controlled. The treatment for type 1 diabetes is insulin therapy, and different types of insulin are available now. We have the regular insulin, NPH, and we have the short and long acting insulin analogs. The short-acting insulin analogs start action within 5 to 15 minutes of injection, and their action is over by 4 hours, so that there is less risk of hypoglycemia compared to regular insulin whose duration of action is 6 to 8 hours. NPH is the intermediate-acting insulin which we have, and that the duration of action is 10 to 18 hours. And for the long-acting insulin analogs, the duration of action ranges from 20 to 42 hours. Degludec is the longest acting, which acts for 42 hours. These insulins are produced by making some alterations in the structure of insulin, whereby the insulin degradation is delayed, or the insulin stays in the subcutaneous tissue either as hexamers or bound to albumin or to fatty acids, so that the duration of action is prolonged. And when we give insulin therapy, our goal is to mimic how the body physiologically maintains euglycemia. So normally there is a basal rate of insulin secretion which happens throughout the day in a normal person, and postprandially there are bursts of insulin secretion as you see in this picture. So the goal of our treatment of type 1 diabetes, where there is absolute insulin deficiency, is to mimic this physiology by giving them basal insulin, either NPH twice daily or a long-acting insulin analog once daily, and giving them either regular insulin or short-acting insulin analogs to cover for the meal-related glucose excursions. And when we start subcutaneous insulin therapy, the dose is usually 0.4 to 0.5 units per kg per day, of which 40 to 50% is basal insulin and 50 to 60% is prandial insulin. And when we decide on the insulin therapy, we should always adjust it to the activity as well as the food, and this is an important aspect to educate patients. Continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion pumps are definitely a better option, but needs a lot of patient education, and you need a motivated patient who is willing to learn the skills of using a pump, as well as monitoring glucose levels at least 4 times every day, so that they don't silently go into decay. Before you discharge any patient admitted for glycemic control for type 1 diabetes, you would check their antibodies and do an ultrasound abdomen to rule out chronic pancreatitis and make sure that they have learned the diabetes self-management skills. So the most important aspects a patient with type 1 diabetes should learn before going home are to know about insulin self-administration in all older children and adults, and insulin administration by the parents only in case of small children below the age of 12 years. And then diet modification, physical activity, monitoring and maintaining a logbook, recognition and management of hypoglycemia, as well as what to do when they are sick. These simple aspects of education should be imparted before discharging any patient home on insulin. When injecting insulin, it is important to identify the proper areas for insulin injection. The most commonly suggested area is the abdomen, around the umbilicus, but also on the flanks. So this is a wider area available for rotation of insulin sites so that they can prevent injecting insulin at the same site multiple times, which can lead to lipohypertrophy. Similarly, when injecting insulin at night or when they are not acting, not very active, they can inject insulin on the anterior thigh so that they have even more, especially smaller children where the area available for insulin injections are smaller. With regard to reuse of the needles and the syringes, it is important to note that the needles are really very small now. We have 6 millimeter and 4 millimeter needles. So even when it gets bent, we cannot physically see it most often. But the problem is, as you can see here, a needle which has been used 6 times has almost become ragged and bent. And when that needle is withdrawn after the injection, it can tear the tissues along the path, and that can lead to fibrosis and scar formation. And over a period of time, such kind of needles, when they're used again and again, can damage the tissues underneath. They induce a fibrotic reaction, and repeated insulin injections at the same time can also cause fat hypertrophy in those areas, known as lipohypertrophy. That can lead to serious problems because when insulin is injected in those areas, the absorption is erratic and unpredictable, and the patient can have frequent hypo and hyperglycemic excursions. When it comes to diet, we are dealing with young people who have to live a long life with diabetes. Hence, it's very important to educate them about the different components of their diet and to advise them about a proper balance of protein, fat, and fiber along with the carbohydrate in their diet in order to reduce the glycemic excursions. We have also successfully started teaching our patients about carbohydrate counting and to think about meal composition so that it allows them more choices of food items with reduced glucose excursions. And we always tell our patients that while interpreting their glucose values as to why it is high or low, they have to think about 3 factors. It's not only the insulin which they have taken, but also the food they have eaten and the amount of physical activity they have done during that period of time, which has an impact on the glucose levels. Coming to physical exercise is also required for type 1 diabetes, where vigorous intensity aerobic activity should be done on a daily basis, along with muscle and bone strengthening activities at least 3 days per week. And if a child is going for an anticipated exercise, that is, it's a regular swimming class, they should reduce their short acting insulin prior to the exercise by 50% to 80%. And also after exercise, there is a risk of delayed hypoglycemia due to increased glucose uptake by the muscles. And hence they have to reduce their long acting insulin also by 20% to avoid this delayed hypoglycemia. And if it is an unanticipated exercise, they should check their glucose values, make sure that is anywhere between 100 to 220. And if it is low, they have to consume glucose or a carbohydrate, preferably a carbohydrate, 0.5 to 1 gram per kg body weight for an exercise duration of 60 minutes. Coming to monitoring, we tell them to monitor their, all patients on insulin should monitor their glucose levels at least 4 to 6 times, that is pre and post meals, and maintain a logbook of their glucose values, insulin dose, as well as their food intake and the duration of activity. This is because when we interpret their glucose values, we cannot just interpret the glucose and the insulin. We also need to know what food they have taken and how much and how active they have been on that particular day and time in order to understand the reasons for glucose fluctuations and educate them how to reduce such fluctuations in future. The targets for glucose levels before meals should be maintained between 80 to 130, after meals below 180, a HbA1c target of less than 7.5, and if a child or an adult is managing very well without much hypoglycemia, you can give them a target of 7%. And the goal should be individualized based on the risk of hypoglycemia and the diabetes management skills. Can we use oral antidiabetic agents in type 1 diabetes? Yes, we can use metformin along with insulin in obese children and adults, and especially when their insulin requirement is more than 0.85 units per kg per day. Hypoglycemia is a definite problem which we encounter in all patients who are on insulin, and the risk of hypoglycemia is anywhere around at least 2 to 3 per week in people with type 1 diabetes and about 2 to 3 per month in type 2 diabetes on insulin. So it is defined as a plasma glucose less than 70. The symptoms here are all familiar, symptoms of autonomic activation, tachycardia, tremors, palpitations, hunger. And if not recognized and managed, a patient with frequent hypoglycemias can have hypoglycemia unawareness, where they don't have any symptoms and they can directly develop seizures, behavioral abnormalities because of hypoglycemia. How do we manage hypoglycemia? In a conscious patient, you can give them 15 grams of carbohydrates, either as 3 spoons of sugar or glucose, retest again after 15 minutes, and as this should be followed by a snack or a meal within 30 minutes because the glucose gets metabolized and they can again develop hypoglycemia. In a confused or unconscious patient, you would give IV glucose or glucagon injection and subsequently put them on a continuous IV glucose infusion until they are well and able to take a meal. So this is an 18-year-old girl diagnosed type 1 diabetes 1 year ago on basal bolus insulin with fever, cough, vomiting. In this day of COVID, you would tell them to come to the hospital for swabbing. But otherwise, the most important thing to keep in mind is never stop insulin when a person is unwell. This is a very important aspect to be emphasized. As I told in the first case earlier that she stopped insulin because of vomiting for a day, and that worsened the DKA in this girl who had frequent episodes of DKA. So when a person is unwell, take 50% to 60% of the total daily dose of insulin. And if the glucose levels are going up, then you need extra doses of short-acting insulin. If the glucose levels are low, they need extra glucose or calories to be given. Glucose monitoring should be done more frequently, every 2 to 3 hours in an unwell patient. Check urine ketones, and if there is persistent vomiting or worsening hyperglycemia and ketosis, then they need hospital admissions. So we have a system where one of our diabetes educator carries a duty mobile, and when a patient is unwell, they contact her, and at least in half the number of cases, they are able to manage by just giving extra doses of insulin or telling them to take their glucose tests more frequently, and many patients are managed at home without having to come to hospital. Only the sick ones need to come to hospital. In the regular monitoring of these patients, we have, because these are children with diabetes, we have to monitor their growth and puberty. In the third case, I mentioned that his sugars were uncontrolled, and so this boy was not growing, his puberty was delayed. Even at the age of 19 years, he only had very few early changes of puberty. And also during each clinic visit, we have to check for injection site lipohypertrophy. We have to check their diary and also check for the recordings, the hypoglycemia, and whether they had awareness of hypoglycemia. HbA1c should be checked once in 3 to 6 months. and also we should screen them appropriately for the diabetes related complications. Screening for microvascular complications should begin at the age of 10 to 11 years or after the person has had diabetes for at least 5 years, and then subsequently check annually. The lipid profile should be checked after the age of 2 years if there is a strong family history of cardiovascular disease, or after the age of 10 years. Blood pressure in children should be checked in relation to the nomograms for their age, gender and height. Foot care should be emphasized during every visit, and the foot has to be checked in every clinic visit. Because type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disorder, they also have other associated autoimmune endocrine and non-endocrine autoimmune conditions, the most common of which is primary hypothyroidism. 25% of patients with type 1 diabetes have thyroid antibodies, and about 4 to 18% have primary hypothyroidism. Hence, it's important to check TSH at the time of diagnosis, but definitely not during a DKA. The point to remember is a patient is very unwell at the time of a DKA, and TSH can be either falsely low or falsely high because of a sick euthyroid syndrome. And hence, always check TSH in a person with type 1 diabetes after achieving glycemic control for at least 2 to 3 weeks and the person is clinically well. Graves' disease, celiac disease and Addison's disease are less common. You should check for these only if there are symptoms of these conditions. Some guidelines suggest that screening for celiac disease should be universally done in the initial at the initial diagnosis of diabetes, while others while in South India we don't see much of celiac disease, but it's more common in North India. So now coming back to the second case, this was a 17-year-old girl again, incidentally diagnosed to have diabetes during a checkup before joining nursing college. She was obese and she had a family history of diabetes only in her father, but not in the other generations. She had polycystic ovarian syndrome and she did not have DKA despite having elevated blood glucose with an A1C of more than 14%. So with this clinical picture, we would diagnose type 2 diabetes mellitus in this girl. Type 2 diabetes is also increasing in adolescents and young adults by about 7% every year because of increasing obesity and sedentary lifestyle. And also children born to pregnant women who had diabetes are at increased risk of subsequently developing type 2 diabetes. So there is varying degree of insulin resistance and insulin secretory defect. The point to note is, compared to adults who have type 2 diabetes, adolescents who develop type 2 diabetes have a rapid worsening of their beta cell function with an annual decline of 20 to 35% in their beta cell function compared to older adults, where the beta cell function decline is about 5 to 10% per year. Also, screening for type 2 diabetes is indicated in children above the age of 10 years or young adults whose BMI is more than 23 kg per meter square in Asians, along with any of the risk factors like having a first degree relative with diabetes. By ethnicity, we are all at high risk. Then when there is a history of a cardiovascular disease, hypertension, dyslipidemia, or when they have PCOS and associated obesity, acanthosis nigricans, etc. So when a person is obese and has risk factors, you would check for type 2 diabetes in adolescents. And with regard to the complications of diabetes, it is unexpected that people with type 2 diabetes who have good insulin secretory reserve should have more complications. But surprisingly, it is true that when you compare people with type 1 versus those with type 2 diabetes, type 2 diabetes individuals had more microvascular complications as well as hypertension in comparison to type 1 diabetes. So the treatment of type 2 diabetes, diet modification, exercise, and if not controlled, add on metformin. Further not controlled, the options are sulfonylurea, using a GLP-1 analog after the age of 10 years or insulin. And here, the goals of therapy are, in addition to normalization of glucose, we have to concentrate on optimizing their body weight and also controlling the other comorbidities like fatty liver, hypertension, and dyslipidemia. Coming to the next common type of diabetes in adolescents, that is MODY, or maturity onset diabetes of the young, seen in about 2 to 6% of all diabetes, with an autosomal dominant pattern of inheritance. When do we suspect MODY? When there is a 3-generation family history of diabetes. Obese, non-obese does not matter. Signs of insulin resistance and absence of diabetes associated autoantibodies. So different types of MODY have been described. Up to 14 types have been described now, of which initially the type 1, 2 and 3 were more commonly recognized and reported from the West. So type 1 and type 3 are similar. They are diagnosed in adolescents and they resemble type 2 diabetes in that they respond to oral agents initially, and subsequently there is progressive beta cell function decline leading on to insulin therapy. Whereas type 2 diabetes, type 2 MODY is characterized by only fasting hyperglycemia, most often doesn't need treatment except during pregnancy. Type 4, 5 and 6 have been recently recognized as important causes of MODY in India, and type 6 is characterized by obesity and insulin resistance. Type 7, 8, 9 and 10 are less common, but there are some classical features of type 8, which is characterized by exocrine and endocrine pancreatic dysfunction along with demyelinating polyneuropathy, and type 10 is more commonly associated with neonatal diabetes. In type 9, so there are some reported cases of diabetic ketoacidosis as well. Again, 11, 12, 13, 14, less common. 12 and 13 are more often associated with neonatal diabetes, but they are also associated with diabetes in adolescents and adults. So this was our study on MODY. The MODY genetic testing was done by Next Generation Sequencing in the genetics lab of our department among 80 patients who were diagnosed to have diabetes less than 35 years of age. Among them, 56 patients had the clinical characteristics with the 3-generation family history of diabetes, absence of beta cell autoimmunity, and no DKA. Among them, 19% had mutations associated with MODY. In contrast to the Western series, what we found in our series was that the NeuroD1 mutations were more common, and also diegenic mutations, that is presence of mutations in two genes, NeuroD1 and PDX, was also more commonly seen in our patients as compared to MODY 1, 2 and 3, which are more commonly reported in the Western series. Similarly, when we looked at pregnant women who had family history of diabetes and screened them for MODY, we found MODY mutations more common in the NeuroD1 and PDX, and the mutations were seen in about 18% of pregnant women. Mitochondrial diabetes is another type of diabetes which we have to keep in mind, which is a non-autoimmune beta cell failure with associated myopathy, cardiomyopathy, deafness, and short stature. Genetic testing by next generation sequencing identifies these mutations, and we are able to do that test in our lab as well. Fibrocalculus pancreatic diabetes is another entity which we have to keep in mind when a person presents with diabetes in a young age, along with abdominal pain and steatorrhea. X-ray abdomen reveals large pancreatic ductal calculi, which can be seen on an X-ray across the T12 and L1 vertebrae. Ultrasound shows pancreatic ductal dilatation. They have compromised beta cell function, and so though initially they may respond to sulfonylureas for a short while, for a few years, more often later on they would require insulin. Pancreatic enzyme supplements are also necessary because they have malabsorption, fat malabsorption, and they have increased risk of pancreatic cancer. With the emerging data on the different etiologies for diabetes, Balasubramaniam et al. Tried to classify diabetes in patients presenting with DKA in adulthood based on the presence or absence of diabetes-associated autoantibodies and presence or absence of adequate beta cell function. So that they called as the A-beta classification. A stands for antibodies and beta is for preserved C-peptide levels. So they studied 294 patients and followed them up for at least 1 year after their initial presentation with DKA. The interesting point to note is that a large proportion of patients during follow-up recovered beta cell function and were antibody negative. So out of these nearly 300 patients, 55% were antibody negative and had good beta cell function. When they looked at newly diagnosed diabetes in adulthood, again, 74% had beta cell function preserved but were antibody negative despite initial presentation with DKA. So mild DKA can be a presenting feature in adulthood diabetes despite having good beta cell function. So when they looked at the accuracy of their classification system using the A-beta system, it had very good sensitivity, more than 99%, and specificity more than 95% for newly diagnosed diabetes as well as those with pre-existing diabetes in young adults. So this led to this new concept of ketosis-prone type 2 diabetes, which has been included in the WHO classification, which is antibody negative diabetes with unprovoked ketoacidosis but reversible beta cell function and glycemic remission with oral agents alone. So we studied these patients with ketosis-prone diabetes in our department. We had 11 patients diagnosed with antibody negative, beta cell function preserved diabetes in young age, and they were prospectively followed up over a period of 1 year. And when this group of patients with ketosis-prone diabetes were compared to the classical type 1 diabetes who were antibody positive and required insulin for survival, the KPD patients, that is the ketosis-prone diabetes patients, were older, had higher BMI, stronger family history of type 2 diabetes, and more severe ketoacidosis. These patients were tested for their beta cell function 2 weeks after the recovery from DKA and subsequently again at 3 months, 6 months, and 1 year. By 3 months, most of the patients were off insulin therapy. All of them were antibody negative. Their C-peptide levels improved and their HbA1c improved to 5.4% without insulin therapy. Now coming to our third case, the 24-year-old person, he is now 24 years old. He had diabetes diagnosed at the age of 3 years, diabetes insipidus at 15 years, optic atrophy. He also had delayed puberty, urinary tract dysfunction, and psychiatric problems with a family history of diabetes in two of his siblings along with diabetes insipidus. So this person has Didmort syndrome or the Wolfram syndrome. This is an autosomal recessive disorder due to mutations in the WFS1 or the CISD2 genes. In the first decade of life, it presents with non-autoimmune diabetes, optic atrophy, and diabetes insipidus, deafness in the second decade of life, and by third decade, they develop urinary tract anomalies, psychiatric disorders, progressive neurological dysfunction, and hypogonadism. Coming to the other rare forms of diabetes, we have the lipodystrophy syndromes, where there is abnormality in fat distribution. So there could be either fat loss throughout the body, especially in the subcutaneous tissue, and fat accumulation in the liver, giving rise to fatty liver and steatohepatitis. And they have severe degree of insulin resistance, presenting with diabetes, hypertriglyceridemia, and because of this, they also have PCOS. Various different types of lipodystrophy syndromes have been described with either generalized fat loss, like in the case shown here, or regional fat loss. This mother and daughter with an autosomal dominant mutation in the lamin gene had fat loss in the limbs and preserved fat in their face, giving a Cushingoid appearance of the face, along with hypertriglyceridemia and diabetes. Another rare form of diabetes which we saw, which we have been seeing recently, is this H syndrome, where there is short stature, cardiac problems, hypothyroidism, hypogonadism, and hearing loss with non-autoimmune diabetes along with hyperpigmentation. So this girl has H syndrome, which is due to an autosomal recessive condition, mutations in this SLC29A3 gene. So coming to the clinical approach to diabetes in young, a detailed history including pedigree charting and a good clinical examination often leads to the right diagnosis. When you have a patient coming in with weight loss, severe DKA, wildly fluctuating glucose levels, you often know it is type 1 diabetes. With obesity, PCOS, family history, and usually absence of DKA or only mild DKA, it is type 2 diabetes. When there is a 3-generation family history of diabetes, antibody negative, and preserved beta cell function, it could be MODY. When you have a patient presenting with abdominal pain, steatorrhea, weight loss, it's pancreatic. When you have an obese adult coming with DKA and who recovers their beta cell function usually within 3 months, that is ketosis-prone diabetes. When you have diabetes with deafness, think of mitochondrial diabetes or Desmoid syndrome. And when you have features of specific syndromes like the lipodystrophy syndromes, which I described, with hepatomegaly, hypertriglyceridemia, and severe insulin resistance, think of lipodystrophy. When you have obesity, hypogonadism, polydactyly, think of obesity syndromes. In the investigation of a young person with diabetes, always check for autoantibodies, GAD65 antibodies in adults and children, and IA2 antibodies only when the presentation is below 15 years of age. Antibodies are positive in type 1 diabetes and as well as the slowly progressive autoimmune diabetes, which is a hybrid type of diabetes. Ultrasound abdomen is required to look for pancreatic ductal dilatation and parenchymal calcification. Patients with MODY5 have renal and genital anomalies, so hence it's important to check for that. Sometimes you would get a report, pancreas not well visualized due to obscured by bowel gas. In such situations, if your suspicion of pancreatic diabetes is high, you may have to do a CT abdomen. C-peptide levels should be checked only after achieving stable blood glucose control. Never check C-peptide in a person who has come in with DKA, because acute hyperglycemia per se inhibits insulin secretion, and that is known as glucotoxicity. Hence, give the patient, when there is a doubt, there is no harm in giving insulin to everybody initially. Patient has come with DKA, treat with insulin, manage as per DKA protocol, and after achieving good glycemic control for at least 2 weeks, then you stop NPH the night before, NPH or glargine the night before, then stop the regular insulin in the morning and check a C-peptide 90 minutes after a meal. A C-peptide more than 1.8 90 minutes after meal indicates adequate beta cell reserve. And after achieving good glycemic control, check a lipid profile, and hypertriglyceridemia and fat loss are indicators of lipodystrophy. So thus, a good clinical examination and basic simple investigations would help you make a diagnosis of the type of diabetes in a young person. So the diagnostic approach, when you have a patient coming in with DKA, it could either be type 1 diabetes where you have antibodies, or it could be a ketosis prone diabetes which is antibody negative. When there is no DKA, an obese person coming with diabetes could be type 2 diabetes or Cushing syndrome. If it's a normal BMI and there is a family history and deafness, think of mitochondrial or Desmoid. Family history but no deafness, then you think of MODY. Sometimes in family history present, and if there is a lipodystrophic phenotype, you could think of that. Without a family history, you could think of pancreatic diabetes, growth hormone excess, or some rare lipodystrophic or syndromic forms of diabetes. When we look at the age-wise distribution of the different types of diabetes, sorry, the first is wrong. It's less than 6 months, you would think of neonatal diabetes due to the mutations which I described. 6 months to 10 years is type 1 diabetes most common, followed by rarely MODY or syndromic forms like Wolfram syndrome. Between the age of 10 to 25, adolescence and young adulthood, still type 1 diabetes is the most common, followed by type 2, MODY, pancreatic or syndromic. Above the age of 25, in the absence of DKA, you would think of type 2 diabetes, and with DKA, think of ketosis prone diabetes, also other types to be looked for in older adults. Managing diabetes in young people is definitely not without challenges, especially when you are managing adolescents who are on insulin. They are going through various physiological and psychological changes. They are becoming more confident, going through eating disorders, peer pressure, irregular meals. So these are real challenges to managing insulin therapy in adolescents. So there are some tricks to help us. So when you have people who have a common disorder, getting them together definitely helps by providing them peer support and also providing youngsters who are on insulin with a structured diabetes education on various aspects of diabetes self-management, involving their families also in this diabetes education would help them in managing their diabetes better. And this is what we observed in our type 1 diabetes clinic, where a structured diabetes education led to improvement in their glycemic control. Over a period of 4 years, their HbA1c declined from 9.6 to 8.3. And the proportion of people who had HbA1c less than 7.5 was only 20% when we started this education program. But as the patients were involved more into diabetes education and good diabetes self-management, nearly 40% had HbA1c less than 7.5 and about 80% had HbA1c below 8.5. At this point, I should tell that Dr. Mohan, who is sitting here with us, helped us collate this data, and he also was with us in these endeavors for diabetes education of our patients. Thank you, and I'm happy to take questions. Insulin types, there are short-acting insulin as well as intermediate and long-acting insulin. And the short-acting insulin is regular insulin, which acts for about 6 hours. It has to be given half an hour before the meal so that it exists as hexamers. It takes time for it to dissociate and get into the bloodstream. With regard to short-acting insulin analogs, aspart, lispro, they act immediately within 5 minutes. And so they can be taken just before the meal. With long-acting insulin analogs, we have glargine and detima, which can be given once daily. Less peaks and troughs compared to NPH, which is the intermediate acting insulin. It has to be given twice daily, acts for about 10 to 16 hours. So these are the different insulins available. Insulin injection devices, we have pens and syringes. The advantage of pen is that the needle is smaller, 4 millimeter. And the injection is a bit more easier with the pen device. Intermittent fasting, it's a separate topic by itself. I think you will have a talk on that subsequently. What is the prevalence of type 1, type 2 MODY in young diabetics? Again, it depends on the age group, as I alluded to in the slide, that in the younger age group, less than 10 years, type 1 is the most common. Between the age of 10 to 25, again, type 1 is most common, followed by type 2, ketosis-prone diabetes, and then MODY. That's how it goes. When can you start patient on SGLT2 inhibitor? Is there any contraindication or warning? SGLT2 inhibitors are associated with euglycemic ketosis. So that is one thing which we have to keep in mind. Patients with type 1 diabetes on insulin, though SGLT2 inhibitors act by a mechanism of causing glycosuria and thereby reducing the glucose levels, it is useful as a supportive therapy, but there may be increased risk of ketosis, and that is why you would sparingly use it. We have not used in any of our patients. Reasonable battery of tests, yes. GAD, C-peptide and ultrasound abdomen, definitely. Islet cell antibodies or the IA2 antibodies only in younger people below the age of 15 years. Time interval for changing insulin syringe, not to be used more than 4 times. Best if the patient can use one insulin syringe every day, because they are taking 3 injections of short regular insulin and one or two injections of NPH per day. So definitely changing one syringe every day is the best. How to send C-peptide to confirm true insulin deficiency who is already started on insulin from outside? Yes, so after achieving good glycemic control for at least 2 weeks, then you tell the patient to not take the NPH insulin on the night before. They can take their regular insulin on the night before. On the morning of the test, don't take NPH as well as regular insulin. Tell them to take a breakfast and give a C-peptide and random plasma glucose 90 minutes after a meal. You can interpret the C-peptide as adequate only when the plasma glucose is more than 140. So that is why you need to measure C-peptide as well as plasma glucose 90 minutes after the meal, and tell the patient that many a times the report is not available on the same day. Tell the patient to restart their usual insulin from that afternoon onwards and to see you further for the reports. If the post-meal C-peptide is more than 1.8 nanograms per ml, it indicates good beta cell reserve. But more often, the lower the C-peptide below 3, you may not be able to completely come off insulin. So when it is above 3, when the C-peptide is more than 3, then you can safely withdraw insulin. What we normally do is that we don't stop insulin altogether at once. We first reduce the short-acting insulin by 50%. We call them after a week. If they are doing well, we add on a sulfonylurea, and then we stop the short-acting insulin, continue the long-acting insulin. And further, we call them after a week. If things are fine, sugars are normal, then we stop the long-acting insulin. So we slowly taper and withdraw insulin over a period of 2 to 3 weeks. We don't do it abruptly, immediately. If we can't send genetic test for MODY, will sending C-peptide help in distinguishing type 1 from MODY? Yes, definitely you can use C-peptide to differentiate type 1 from MODY. In type 1, the beta cell reserve will be very poor. Post-meal C-peptide will be less than 1.8, whereas in MODY, they will have preserved beta cell function. Even in type 2, their C-peptide will be always more than 5 to 6. MODY genetic testing in our lab is not very costly. For 13,000 rupees, we test for 40 genes, which includes genes associated with MODY, insulin resistance, and lipodystrophy. So in our lab, it is not very expensive because we are following this NGS technique, and so it is cost effective. But if a patient cannot afford, definitely you can check the C-peptide and decide about changing over to oral agents. In resource limited setting, investigation necessary for evaluation of diabetes in young, GAD antibodies and C-peptide is necessary for everyone. Yes, definitely GAD antibodies in everyone, and C-peptide you will check after achieving stable glycemic control. C-peptide fasting is not very useful, especially if you are resource limited and you have to do only one test, you will do it after a meal. In endocrinology, the dictum is when you want to check for deficiency, you check at the time when it is at the maximum level. So C-peptide is at the maximum after you have given a meal challenge, and so check only after the meal. Fasting C-peptide is not very useful, though a fasting C-peptide more than 0.8 is taken as an indicator of beta cell reserve. Are anti-GAD antibodies considered to be the most sensitive? Yes, they are the most sensitive for type 1 diabetes, and they seen in about 70% of people with type 1 diabetes, and they persist for longer duration. So they persist for up to 10 years or more after the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes, whereas IA2 and anti-insulin antibodies, they disappear within about 2-3 years after the diagnosis. Comment on tropical diabetes. Tropical diabetes is the same as fibrocalcific pancreatic diabetes, which I alluded to. So this is seen in tropical countries, and there is large main pancreatic ductal calculi, and that's how they present with abdominal pain, steatorrhea, malabsorption. Elevated sugars during COVID in previously non-diabetic, this is quite often seen, most often temporary due to steroid, yes. So at that time when you are giving them dexamethasone is a potent glucocorticoid that can increase glucose levels in a person who has pre-diabetes or at risk of diabetes. So you give them insulin for that short period of time. A basal bolus regimen where you give a long-acting insulin once daily and you give them short-acting insulin thrice daily before the meals is best. Because you are going to give them insulin only for a short duration, I do not recommend to prescribe glargine, which most often you have to inject with a pen. The pen itself is 1000 rupees. You don't have to invest on that unnecessarily when you're giving insulin for short duration. You can give twice daily NPH and thrice daily Actrapid before the meals. And one point to keep in mind when you're using steroids once daily is that evening around 6 o'clock is the time for the peak glucose levels. So make sure you check a glucose level before dinner so that you know what's happening with the profile of glucose. Do young onset type 2 have more complications, much faster, preventable? Yes. As I alluded to in the slide where I showed you the comparison between type 1 and type 2, type 2 diabetes in younger age have more complications and they have complications earlier. Definitely it is preventable with good glycemic control and also addressing the other factors like obesity, hypertension, etc. Are they prone for diabetes in later life if they have diabetes due to steroids? Yes, that indicates that they have either severe insulin resistance or an associated insulin secretory defect, which is unable to cope when you give a stress in the form of a steroid. So obviously these patients are definitely at higher risk of developing diabetes later in life. Type 2 progressing to type 1. Is categorized under what category of diabetes? Type 2 progressing to type 1 has not been described. So are you talking about a person who is obese and has type 1 diabetes? If that is the case, then an obese person presenting with DKA, treat them for the DKA, treat them with insulin initially, and subsequently check their C-peptide after 2 weeks of good diabetes control. As I showed you earlier, patients with ketosis-prone diabetes can have a phenotype of type 2 diabetes, that is they are obese, have signs of insulin resistance, family history of diabetes, but they can present with severe DKA also, and they recover beta cell function after treatment of the DKA. Some more questions are there?
Chart box.
Okay, how do we guide obese patients on insulin in their goals to reduce weight? So obese patients, if they are able to exercise, do some walking, running, skipping, that will be good. Vigorous exercise is what helps these patients. Some patients would have developed osteoarthritis and would not be able to weight bear. For them, swimming would be a good exercise if they can do that, and also cutting down on their calories and increasing the intake of fiber will promote hunger and thereby prevent them from overeating. And taking more fiber and proteins will also help reduce the glucose fluctuations, and thereby they can maintain better glycemic control. Role of octreotide in secondary diabetes. So thinking of octreotide, I can think of only two situations, maybe glucagonoma and somatostatinoma. But the problem with octreotide is, in addition to suppressing glucagon, it also suppresses insulin secretion. So it is not very useful for treating the diabetes per se. How does knowing GAD levels change the line of management of type 1 diabetes? Is it only that we can give OADs for initial few years if it is LADA? So if it is type 1 diabetes, GAD antibodies helps confirm the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes, but the absence of GAD antibodies does not rule out type 1 diabetes. As I said, GAD antibodies are positive only in 70% of patients. So still there are 30% of patients who are GAD negative. But when they are GAD negative, that makes you think whether there could be other forms of diabetes, maybe syndromes, maybe MODY. So these are the things which you can keep in mind. And with regard to LADA, LADA resembles type 1 diabetes, but more often they don't present with DKA in the initial presentation. This is a diabetes with autoimmune features, that is GAD antibodies positive, but they have some beta cell function, and you will be able to manage them with OADs for anywhere between 6 months to 5 years, usually require insulin within 5 years of diagnosis. Physician doing private practice, what is the procedure to refer patients to CMC for genetic testing for MODY? Definitely, you can write an email to our department and we will send you the form as well as the method of payment. So you can fill the form with the clinical details of the patient and we will also guide you as to how to make the payment for MODY genetic testing and you can just send the sample, no need to send the patient.
Can put our email ID in CMC endo CMC number.
Endocrine at cmcvellore.ac.in.
Thank you very much, Asha. We all learned a lot, and I think that all nobody left. People were only keeping on joining till the end, and I think that with your permission, we'll upload this on the YouTube, and there'll be many more questions for you as well. We are very grateful. We learned a lot, and it was really eye-opener for us. And I think you've taken a lot of time to prepare all this. So thank you. We are very, very grateful to you. Thank you, Mohan. I didn't know that you had helped Asha and team for doing some of the diabetes work as well. I think you are
Mohan
making
was working with us earlier, sir.
I think Mohan has gone to heavy lifestyle, like he seems to be. Thanks, Mohan, and thank you to the telemedicine team. Once again, thank you, Asha. We hope to see you again sometime for some other future talk. Maybe we can get fasting talk from you sometime later.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
It was a good interaction. Thank you all.
Thank you. All right. Bye.